wondering, what you're all going to finish up at your late school, right? You might be a doctor or something like that. You never know when you finish your schooling. There's a young fellow over there, he might play rugby for Otago, mightn't he? Oh, I can see that. You've already got one tooth knocked out. Yes. So it's quite interesting. You don't know where you're going to end up. And I began to think about that myself when I went to school. And I thought back years and years ago, way back into the 1940s and 1950s when I went to school. And I thought of the kids that were in my class and what they'd done after they left school. And I wrote this little poem about it called Who Would Have Thought? Who would have thought as I walked down the road to catch the old school bus, the things I would see and the people I would meet as I walked through the potholes and duck. Who would have thought of those kids back then? Those kids on the country round, what this life would hold for them, what path through life they would find. Now, who would have thought that my friend Ken would end up a millionaire? And Michael, from down at Little Rakaia, he'd serve four terms as mayor. Who would have thought that the vicar's daughter, with her skin that was soft, would become a world famous genius, a full grown professor at Yale. Now, who would have thought that one day I'd own my grandfather's Springbrook farm? When I'd rise in the early morning to the sound of the clock alarm. And who would have thought as I sat on my stool, milking old Lucy the cow by hand, that now they'd milk 1,000 cows by machines and a single man. Who would have thought as I tilled the land years ago on my old Model C case, when I ploughed 6 acres in a 12-hour day at a slow and leisurely pace, that now they'd live in luxury, air-conditioned cabs with stereos and GPS, and four-wheel drive, awesome power, and they'd plough and roll and till and sow 60 acres in a single day. Who would have thought that one day I'd breed the best stud bull in the land, and one day I'd be the pipe major of a champion Highland pipe band? And who would have thought as I gazed at the stars years ago, one night in June, that I would live to see the day when a man would walk on the moon. So as I look back down the road of my life, and I think of that life with its ups and its downs, the things I would see, the people I would meet, on the countryside to the cities and towns, from time to time, with my poetic urge, my pen and my paper I took. And who would have thought that one day I'd launch my very own poetry book? There you are. When I went to school, all those years ago, we had a teacher called Mr. Chappell, and he was a very, very good teacher. And he taught us lots of poetry, and he read poetry to us, and lots of stories he read to us. And little did I know that I was going to write my own stuff. I had no idea at that stage in my life, and I was about the same age as you. And we sat in a seat with a little desk like you've got, and there was a little hole up in the right-hand corner, and it was called an inkwell, because you never had ballpoint pens like you do. You had a just like a paintbrush, except it had a wee nib on the end of it, just a wee sharp nib, and you dipped it in the ink, and then you wrote, and it would run out after about 2.5 words, and you had to dip it in again and carry on. And so that's where I was sitting when Mr. Chappell was reading these poems. And there's one I can quote you just a little bit from that just shows you what him reading that poem to me, what it did to me. It was called The Charge of the Light Brigade, and it was written by Alfred Lord Tennyson. And the Light Brigade was a famous battle battalion, and they rode on the horses into battle. And here it was, and it starts off like this. I've got to think back a long while now. Yes. How did it start?
Yeah.
I know the second line.
So you memorise them obviously, and therefore, yeah.
Anyway, it goes like this. I'll go in the second line, I can't think of the first line. Into the valley of death rode the 600. There were cannon to the left of them, cannon to the right of them, cannon in front of them. They volleyed and thundered. Into the valley of death rode the 600. And I was no longer sitting in that little desk. I was at the front of that brigade with my sword in hand, and I was riding on my white stallion. That was what the poetry did to me. And the rhythm of the poem, cannon to the left of them, cannon to the right of them, you can hear the horses' hoofbeats. And they rode in and they hailed down the big cannonballs, which were about that round. And at the finish of it, most of them were dead, horses and all. And there's a famous painting of it. And the horses were all lying, either dead or wounded, and the men. And the valley floor was covered in cannonballs. There's 600 soldiers there were, the gallant 600. So that's why I got interested in poetry. And I didn't know, I went home from school onto my father's farm, and I had to, a lot of tractor work because we grew lots of crops on the place, and that was my main job, was driving the tractor. And so I'm out there sitting, driving away and looking at what's going on around me, and I thought, oh, I'll put that into words. And so I started to do what I'd done at school, memorise. We had to memorise our poetry that we learned at school. And I think you people have all had a little school production recently, is that right? Where you had to get up on the stage in front of all the crowd. And you would have to have memorised your words, wouldn't you? What you were going to say. So that's what I did. I memorised my words out on the tractor. And little did I know that I was going to be sitting here at Lawrence all these years later telling you some of these little stories. But it wasn't until 2006 that I actually brought them out. And I just kept them stored away in my head. My sister, my older sister, rang me one day and she said, "Colin, there's a big poetry competition in Christchurch and you should enter that." And I said, "That'll be the day, Margaret. I'm not going to do that, get up on the stage." And she said, "No, you should, because I think you'll do well." So I went into this poetry competition, and they had three judges. One came from Ireland, one came from New York City, and one from New Zealand. And nobody had ever heard of me. And I didn't know anyone else when I went into the room, and it was packed full of people. They were even sitting down the aisles. And So I had to get up and recite my poetry. And I had to have three poems. And the first one, if you got through that round, if the 12 people that they'd sorted out the first day, which I'd got into, came down to six, and your second poem got you down to first, second, or third. And your third poem, that's what you were. You were either one or two, or got second or third. So I'd got right through to those last three, and then I went through and won it. So all of a sudden, everyone wanted to hear my poetry, and it was quite an amazing story. So perhaps I could tell you the little story that actually won me that competition. It's one of my favourite ones. And at the start of it, I ask a lot of questions. I want you to kind of see if you can work out who is asking the questions. What sort of a person is asking these questions? And what I was doing that day, I was sitting in my tractor ploughing this paddock. And it was a long paddock, and all I had to do was turn at the end and put the plough in the ground, and I was looking at everything I could see from my tractor cab. And way down to the north, as I drove that way, I could see the Southern Alps, and they're all covered in snow, beautiful, sunny day like today. And we had prime lambs in a paddock and stud bulls in a paddock nearby, and when I turned the corner and looked the other way, I could see the sun shining off Lake Ellesmere, that's quite near where our farm is, and four hills in the background. And coming over the cab were hundreds and hundreds of seagull and sea martins, and they were diving in for all the worms that I was turning up out of the ground. And it was a frenzied fight to get them. And I thought, gee, this is great what I'm seeing. And here was the poem. What a wonderful world this is, and it is a wonderful world. And here we go. Yeah. I'm not usually this rusty, but I haven't done any performing for a long time. But anyhow, here we go. Have you ever gone down to the coastline and smelt the salt spray of the sea?
Yeah.
Have you listened in spring to an old blackbird sing when she builds her nest high in a tree? Have you felt the warm rays of the sunshine on your face on a cold, frosty morning? Have you heard the bees wing of the clover in spring for the wind? Dawn. Have you heard the first bleat of a newborn lamb when it cries to its mother for milk? Have you heard the cat purr when you stroke its soft fur, or the sound of its tongue lapping milk? Do you remember the warmth of your mother when she cuddled you close when you were three? With your fingers did you trace lines on your granddad's kind face when he read you a story at me? Did you smell the sweet smell of your grandma with her hands all wrinkled and worn and her home-cured ham and that strawberry jam on her scones and her pikelets adorned? Well, they say that the moon is pale yellow and the stars twinkle bright in the sky. And there's a red rose in bloom outside my room. And so blue is a sunny blue sky. Sometimes I wish I could see them. Oh, what a sight to behold. Yet the things that I hear, and touch, and smell, make my life far richer than gold. For these are the things that most matter, the things that should bring you most joy. Rugby, cricket and such doesn't mean much to a little blind 10-year-old boy. So the next time you feel like complaining and you wish in your heart you were dead, spare a thought or three for a blind boy like me when you cuddle up warm in your bed. For life is just full of surprises. If only like me, you could see the things in this life worth having are all round you. Enjoy them. They're free. Did anyone pick at the start who was asking the question? Anyone get that one? It turned out later on. Who was it? Who asked the question? Yes?
The 10-year-old boy.
Yes, and what was he?
Blind.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Blind people are amazing. Often people with disabilities, and I see the wee girl over here with the crutches.
Wee boy.
Time for a haircut, Oakley.
Sorry about that, Charlie. You're on crutches at the moment, and you've already worked out how to get around, get over that fact that you've got a sore leg at the moment. And they do. People have got disabilities. They often make it up with other things. And in some cases, become much better than even people that haven't got disabilities. So that's a little story about the blind boy and how the things he could see just by listening. He's got terrific hearing. Lots of them get very sensitive hearing, and they can pick up. There's a lady lives opposite us there at the farm, and she's completely blind, and she goes away out down the road, and she can pick up a car coming miles away, and she moves off the road and lets them go past, and things like that. They're very sensitive hearing. Makes up for their eyes and their touch. They can touch things and they know, and the smell. So they would hear the bee's wing to the clover in spring much better than you or I do. That's the sort of thing they see through their senses. Right. Now, what other one am I going to do? I better have a look at my wee note.
I think Amelia talked about one, didn't you? Did you?
I was going to say one. I have a granddaughter called Amelia.
Oh, that sounds like a good one, Amelia. Shall we listen to that one?
No, it's all right, Amelia. He's got one.
It just started off. I just do one line. And I just thought of it this morning. I was telling Amelia before she went off to school that I was going to tell one about him. There was a young girl called Amelia who likes to tail lambs with her dad. And that's the first line of it. And I'll leave it there, Amelia. So you can relax. Yes. Oh, this is one that I like doing. Because I'm a farmer and that, I'm out around and I see all sorts of things in nature. And I see the life cycle of all sorts of things, whether it be insects or birds. And we've got a walkway down our farm, which runs along the side of Hart's Creek. And there's all sorts of things happening on that walkway. And the ducks at the moment, the ducks are nesting, and the white swans. And it's great to see them all hatching out and they grow up. And next thing, they're flying, and it's great. And so being a farmer, you see all these things. You see your lambs being born and your calves being born and all this sort of thing. So This is a little poem I put together. Does anyone know what the difference is, or what the difference is between predators and prey? Right.
Predators are the animals what go for the prey. The prey is the food.
Good boy. That is absolutely perfect. Absolutely perfect answer. I'll give you 10.5 out of 10 for that. Brilliant. So this is a little story about survival of one species on another, predator and the prey. And I saw this when I was out raking some hay one day. I've seen it lots of times, but this day I saw it all taking place in a paddock quite near to me. And so there was I sitting on my tractor as usual, and I started to put it into a poem called Survival. Now here we go. Have you ever gazed at the endless sky? When the wispy clouds just drifting by, and a hungry hawk is circling high as he scans the earth for his prey. While far below is a hungry hare, in the summer grass he's grazing there, of the pending threat he's unaware as he fossicks around for his food. But the hungry hawk, as he circles high, he spots the hare with his eagle eye, and if one's to live, then one must die, and he sets to mount the attack. With folded wings, he's an awesome sight, and he cuts through the air like a sharpened knife. With a hapless hawk fixed in his sights, he plummets down for a kill. But the weary hare, with uncanny sense, he spots the hawk in full descent, and he scampers safely to the fence to live for another day. While a hungry hawk, with his eagle eye, climbs back up to the endless sky, where the wispy clouds are still drifting by, to search once more for his prey.
That's it.
So that's what happened that day. The hare got away. Jumped into a hedge just before the hawk. Got him!
Have you got another one, Bandy? Time for another one?
Yes.
Yes. You all right?
I could just perhaps finish with the one on Hart's Creek. We've done a job on Hart's Creek. It was quite dirty, lots of streams are these days, and we had a meeting with all the farmers up the creek and formed a little committee, and we've restored it all, fenced it all, planted thousands of native plants on it, and it's beautiful now. The water's crystalline clean, and it's full of fish and everything, and the birds are nesting, and it's lovely. Wish I bought you the DVD that the lady sent me of the fantails building their nest. It's absolutely fascinating to see them coming in with their beaks full of moss and threading it all in round, and the lady's taking it with her camera at very close range. It's marvellous.
We might be able to do that when we come down next time.
Anyhow, I wrote this little poem just simply called Hart's Creek. We must all think of the future and correct the mistakes of the past. If humankind is to survive for 1,000 years of past, We must take care of our water as it makes its way to the sea, and not pollute the atmosphere for my grandchildren and me. What a rise of pristine water from the springs at the head of Hart's Creek, which winds its way through rich barren land to the lake, even as we speak. It must be kept in top condition. Solutions we must find and provide a home for the fish and game for the sake of all mankind. There you are.
You got another one there?
Pardon?
You got time for another one?
That's all right. Yeah, plenty of time.
Yeah, I know. But I mean, we don't want to cut into
it. Yeah, no.
Yeah.
No. What can I do? Thought that would probably be about as long as you'd need. But,
yeah.
I believe you enjoyed the little song.
Oh, that's a good one. Do that one.
Perhaps I could do that, sing that little song for you about the finest people. And it tells the story of my great-grandparents who came out from Ireland and Scotland and settled here in New Zealand. If they hadn't have come out, goodness knows where I would have been. Not certainly not New Zealand, most probably. But they came out in an old sailing ship. It took them nearly 100 days to sail through the ocean on an old sailing ship, up and down, and one of the children was just 2 years old, and he learnt to walk on the ship. And when the storms got really bad, they roped him to the big mast that came down from the top through the where they slept, so that he wouldn't break his leg or something when the So they tied him to the mast. And that's the sort of thing they came out through to get here. And I'm very grateful they did. So I put this little song together. And you might be able to join in the chorus when I get to that. Oh, they were the finest people that you will ever see. Me granddad, he was Scottish, and me granny, she was Cree. Oh, they left old Ireland bonny shores 100 years ago, and came out to New Zealand for to plow and for to sow. And when they reached New Zealand shore that calm and sunny day, the Maoris heard them coming 15 miles away. Oh, my granddad stood upon the bridge of singing tunes and airs, while granny sat upon the deck and wiped away her tears. And Bob and Tom and little John were skidding round the deck. There's cheering and there's shouting, but they didn't care a hit. Oh, they were the finest people that you will ever see. Me granddad, he was Scottish, and me granny, she was green. So they moved on out to Lakeside to get upon the land, to plow and sow and reap and mow, it would be really grand. They must have lost a lot of sweat, a clearing of the land, digging all the drains and grubbing rushes out by hand. They'd rise before the sun each day and go to milk the cows, then get the old draft horses in and hook them to the ploughs. Then tread the dusty fields all day for nigh on 13 hours. Then let the tired old horses loose and go back to milk the cows. Oh, they were the finest people you will ever see. Me granddad, he was Scottish, and me granny, she was green. So come all you little girls and boys and listen to my song. If you can grow up just like them, you never will go wrong. They never had no tractors and they never had no cars. They never had no ice cream or chocolate-coated bars. They'd never seen a telly or heard a radio. They'd never heard of skateboards or fancy-coloured clothes. Yet they were so happy with their meagre lot. You never heard them to complain at the prices that they got. A bullock. Shilling and a bullock for a pound, a dozen eggs for threepence, and a bull for half a crown. Oh, they were the finest people that you would ever see. My granddad, he was Scottish, and my grandma, she was green. Oh, I am so very thankful that they came out this way, for I would hate to be away back there amongst the fray. But back in Northern Ireland, there's still a fighting yet. There's things that happened long ago they never will forget. They're fighting and they're scrapping and they're blowing up the bars. There's shooting and there's bloodshed and they're burning brand new cars. Well, here am I living right next door to John O'Boyle. Now I'd be out at night and throwing weeds upon his soil. I'd be knocking off these pigs to keep me in my Christmas ham, while he'd be turning wild dogs loose in amongst my lamb. Yes, we owe it all to Grandad of 100 years ago, for coming to New Zealand for to plow and for to sow. And just one last chorus, seeing you're so good at singing. For they were the finest people that you would ever see. My granddad, he was Scottish, and my granny, she was green. There you are. So that's a little bit of old bagpipes, granddad. And his poetry and how I come to do it.
It was good,
isn't it? What I learned at school, it all started there. Right.